Good morning, folks. Good morning to everybody who's joined the webinar. Thank you so much for taking time. We are right on the dot right now. We'll wait for a couple of minutes. People are joining as I speak. So let's just wait for a couple of minutes and then we'll get started. Thanks for your patience and we'll get started soon. All right, folks. Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. I'd like to first thank all of you for joining this webinar. Today, myself, Mayur, and my co-presenter, Anup, we're going to talk about DevOps automation for container-based application delivery. We'll also talk about a concept called zero complexity DevOps. Once again, thanks for taking time, and let's get started. Before we get into the webinar, a little bit about the logistics. This webinar is being recorded. The recording as well as the slides that we present today will go up on our website after this live broadcast so that later on you can view it as per your convenience. Also, during the webinar, as you have questions, I would encourage you to use the Q&A chat window to put in your questions. At the end of the webinar, we will spend a good 10 to 15 minutes of the webinar session to take your question and answers and answer them. And if you have any other additional questions or detailed follow-ups that you need, feel free to send us an email, go to waymaker.com/contact and give us send us your inquiry. Also, you can use your chat window to show your interest and we will get back to you after the webinar. Quickly on the agenda itself, we're going to spend the first half of the webinar basically talking about application delivery using containers. We're going to talk about the benefits, challenges, and solutions that we have to offer for containerized based application delivery. After that, we'll go into a deep dive demonstration of a real world application and an application delivery of that using containers using our high-scale product. So Anup, who's on the call, will do the demonstration of that use case. And then we'll end the session with talking about a couple of case studies, real-world case studies about how Highscale has increased the productivity of a couple of use cases. And we'll talk about a free assisted trial that we have to offer, and we'll go over the Q&A session. A little bit about the presenters today. My name is Mayur Shah. I've been in Waymaker for the last 4 years. My background is middleware and application development, having worked at companies like BEA Systems, Cisco Systems, and Informatica. With me today, I also have Anup. Anup, can you quickly introduce yourself to the audience?
Thanks, Mayur. Hi, everyone. This is Anup. I run engineering for Waymaker Highscale. Prior to Waymaker, I've done a couple of entrepreneurial stints, and I've also built a global cloud and DevOps practice for a multinational organization, and now bringing all of that experience to Waymaker.
Thanks, Anup. A little bit also about our company. We are part of Waymaker. Waymaker is headquartered out of Mountain View, California, and basically focuses on providing a suite of products around rapid application delivery. Waymaker company is a subsidiary of a parent company called Pramati Technologies. For those who may not know about Pramati has been around for almost two decades now. It's a company that is well known in the middleware and application development and cloud space. It's a global company having offices all over the world. And work with a number of Fortune 500 customers. We partner them to modernize their application infrastructure. So let's get started. If you look at modern businesses today, every modern business is a digital business or aspiring to be one. The singular focus of today's modern digital business is around innovation at speed with quality. And this level of innovation requires a fundamental shift and thinking in the way application delivery is done. The application delivery needs to be one that allows the business to be more agile, because more businesses want to deliver their applications and products faster to the market. One that allows the business to operate at scale, be it scale out or scale in, and one that allows the business to continuously deliver in order to support that innovation. One of the things we have seen in the history of technology development is that every business transformation requires a technology that can support to further its cause. In case of application delivery, modern application delivery is all about being agile and being rapid and innovative. To support that, there has to be a technology that can further its cause. In the past few years, we have seen the emergence of the container technology or containerization that helps greatly in addressing that. Let's talk a little bit about application delivery and the role of containers in it. If you fundamentally look at application delivery, there are four specific elements. First and foremost is the ability for your applications, be it custom applications or packaged applications, to package those applications with all its dependencies and configuration so that you can provision it in various environments. Once the packaging is done, then it's the ability to take that application and deploy it to set up various environments based on your application lifecycle so that you can go through that and quickly deliver your application to the market. You also want the applications to scale depending on the business needs of the business. It could be the ability to scale up as well as scale down. And finally, your applications have to run on an infrastructure, and businesses are always looking for cost optimization and higher resource utilization. In all of these four areas of application delivery, container technology has a number of benefits. And let's talk a little bit about that. For those who are new to containers, containerization is a much more advanced form of virtualization, and it's a much more optimized form of virtualization. We all know of virtualization in the context of virtual machines, which is basically virtualizing the infrastructure. With containerization, you are basically virtualizing the operating system. On a given infrastructure and the operating system, you have a very thin Docker engine, and on top of that, you can now create containers, which basically are isolated onto which you can deploy applications and run your workloads. The advantage of containers are twofold. For one, because they don't have an hypervisor and a guest operating system, they are extremely lightweight. And secondly, they solve a very important problem in software development, which is about portability. In containers, you have an executable package into which you can package all your application and its dependencies and configuration, and have that package then be deployed in multiple environments and multiple infrastructures. So essentially, the benefits of containers are they are extremely lightweight, they are portable, they allow for super fast provisioning, and finally, they make your infrastructure resource efficient, which can reduce your cost. So we talked about application delivery, we talked about containerization, and what we are seeing is across various industries and various businesses, containers are being adopted. Some have adopted it for their production workloads, and some are in the process of adopting to that level. What we are seeing with every new technology, in case of containerization as well, as businesses adopt them, they are seeing that they need to understand the skills, they need to have the skills in order to use containerization to the full potential. They need to understand the nitty-gritties of how to use containers and sort of build a framework around it so that they can use it to deploy their workloads. And also, they need the ability to use containerization so that it causes minimal disruption in their existing processes, in their existing applications, and in their existing workflow. So in order to address all of these challenges that businesses of all kinds face today in adopting containerization, we see that there is a need of a platform, right? So that businesses can effectively use containerization in their application delivery. Let's talk a little bit about some of the elements of the platform that are required. First and foremost, as I talked earlier, the platform needs to support minimal disruption to existing teams and existing developer workflows. The platform needs to support the ability to take different kinds of workloads. It could be traditional workloads, legacy applications, monolithic applications, and a lot of modern digital businesses are innovating on using microservices type of application, so they need to support that as well. One of the things we are seeing is businesses of all nature are shifting their workloads to run from on-premises to now run them on public clouds, some in cases of some dedicated public clouds, or in some cases multiple clouds. And so the platform needs to support that kind of a deployment model in a unified fashion. Also, as we talk about continuous innovation, it's really all about continuous integration and continuous deployment. And the best way to achieve that is to automate so that there are no manual errors and there are no hiccups in the application delivery lifecycle. One of the things that we are seeing with containerization, with as businesses adopt them, is to make sure that the teams that adopt containerization and use them for application delivery can still continue to focus on the application needs and not have to worry about the underlying nitty-gritties of the container integration and the container frameworks. So the platform needs to provide that level of abstraction so that DevOps teams can focus on the application, which is their sort of their primary concern. And finally, with any new technology, there's also an importance given to infrastructure cost savings, right? So businesses are looking to optimize their infrastructure costs so that they can use this technology for to get better ROI on it. And that's where we talk about Waymaker HighScale. Waymaker HighScale is a containerized application delivery product from Waymaker. In fact, the product was incepted and has been using container technology since the Docker version 0.3, which is almost about since the time Docker containerization came into being. There are two specific areas which Waymaker HighScale is designed for. One is around automation, which is providing complete DevOps automation for containerized application delivery. and we'll talk about that automation. And second, it's around simplicity. I've talked a lot about causing less disruption. And so with the high scale, there's a design focus around providing a lot of simplicity in its adoption and in its management to a level such that there can be zero complexity in your DevOps teams. So we'll talk about these as we go on in the slide deck. In terms of the DevOps automation using high scale, let's talk a little bit about that. With high scale, what you could do is you get in your custom application, which could be any workload of your choice. This could have your custom stacks. You can have your custom applications. With your custom application, HighScale is able to do three distinct things. For one, it will take your application and containerize the entire application stack with all its different services and different stack components automatically. Once the application stack is containerized, it allows for quick provision of that application into various environments to provide release automation. These environments could be any number, could be across any different environments, and allows for quick and easy provisioning of these environments. And finally, once the applications are provisioned in various environments, HighScale is then able to orchestrate and administer those workloads in order to meet your business SLAs. And there we have the ability to auto-scale, auto-heal, and we'll talk about that as well. In essence, what you're getting with HighScale is a container-based continuous delivery of your application using an automation in place. One of the things about HighScale is that it does all of this with containers under the hood, which means that for the teams, it still allows the teams to focus on their application while it manages the containers underneath the covers. Let's talk a little bit about zero complexity DevOps. We talked earlier about the four stages of application delivery lifecycle, which is containerize, deploy, scale, and optimize. And for each of these, HighScale provides unique benefits. From a containerization standpoint, what HighScale does is it can take any legacy app or a microservices modern app, and it can automatically containerize those workloads. We call that as an automagic image creation, and we'll demonstrate that in our demonstration today. In case of deployment, what HighScale can do is take your application and create application blueprints, and these blueprints allows for then a unified provisioning of your application into various environments, be it hybrid environments or multi-cloud environments. These blueprints serve as a very effective means of deploying your application to various environments without any errors in the process. In terms of scalability, HighScale allows your application to auto-scale and auto-heal to make sure that your business SLAs are always maintained. And finally, in case of optimization, HighScale has unique ability to provide greater resource utilization over and above Docker containers. We have certain innovations built into the platform that can allow for easy hibernation, easy passivation, and automatic activation that then allows for greater resource utilization over and above Docker containers. Let's talk now a little bit about automatic containerization. What we've seen across multiple businesses is that businesses have workloads of different nature. Some have legacy applications, some have monolithic applications, and some have microservices-based applications. These applications themselves come in different form factors. You know, some are still using their traditional approaches to deliver their application as WAR files or as library files, and some use Docker images to deliver their application. In either of these cases, Waymaker HighScale can take these various inputs and automatically containerize the workloads using a single-touch, one-click containerization option. We call this as automagic containerization because now the DevOps teams do not have to worry about writing Docker files, understanding Docker scripts, using command line utilities, and basically trying to understand the nitty-gritties of the technology. It provides an easy and easy console where the automagic can happen. Those workloads that are now containerized can then be deployed in a unified fashion to various environments. This is where the blueprint concept comes in. With blueprint, it allows teams to first define or compose the application as various stack elements, including the application itself and the base images. And that blueprint then can also include the configuration that is required to run the application in various environments. With the blueprint now, teams can easily, in a matter of minutes, take an application and deploy, create new application environments. These environments can run on-premises on your existing infrastructure within your private data center, or can run on any dedicated public cloud instance or a private cloud instance, either on Amazon or Azure or on any other cloud provider like Google. In this way, it provides a unified mechanism to deliver your application across both public as well as private clouds. A lot of businesses today use pipeline mechanisms to automate their release automation. We've heard of a lot of companies use Jenkins. With Waymaker Highscale, it provides a mechanism to easily integrate with a pipeline tool like Jenkins. You know, when using Jenkins, you may have a set of tasks as shown here, as which constitute your pipeline. And at various stages of the pipeline, you may want to deploy an application as containers in a container environment. Waymaker provides a specialized Jenkins plugin that can integrate with Jenkins in a configuration manner, and then allows the pipeline to deploy the application to a containerized environment. The other thing that Waymaker Highscale does is it provides RESTful APIs, so that if you use some other tool, you can also integrate with Waymaker Highscale using those APIs. Let's talk a little bit about use cases now. In terms of use cases, we have seen a number of use cases that are powered by Highscale. Number of businesses can now take, lift and shift their legacy applications and use Highscale to have a containerized deployment. And this can happen in a matter of days as opposed to months. We've seen businesses use Highscale to deploy their workloads in a hybrid as well as multi-cloud environment. A lot of modern digital businesses use microservices. Waymaker Highscale is a natural fit for those deployments because it can easily deploy those microservices as containers in the environment. We support continuous delivery. And finally, we support infrastructure cost optimization by using container technology and by some of the innovations that are built into the platform as well. With that, I would like now to hand over the session to Anoop, who's going to demonstrate containerized application delivery using Highscale. Over to you, Anoop.
Thank you, Mayur. So you should be able to see my screen in just a few seconds. All right. So this screen that you're seeing here is the Highscale setup that we have for this demo. So this is an instance of Highscale. And what you're looking at here is the apps page. There are a number of apps here. What I'll be doing is I'll be running through one of the apps and one of the application stacks, the blueprint of a particular application stack that Mayur mentioned. And then we'll see how that stack can be easily provisioned with just a few clicks onto different providers. And then I'll also briefly touch upon how you can automatically create container images from the scripts that you might already have, the various software packages that you use. And finally, we'll run through a little bit of you know, how you can do CI/CD using Jenkins plus Highscale, and then a glimpse on the infrastructure side of things as well. So I'll get started. Let's get into this app. So this particular app is called Dublin. That's the name of the application. And within this app, you see that there is a stack for this app. So there's it has four services. So there's an Apache at the front. There's a UI application and an API application, both of which are built on top of Java. So they run on Tomcat. And then you have a MySQL database. So typical three-tier, and these are the services of the application that you see, and the images on which they are based. And it's fairly easy to add a new service to the stack. You go through the add a service wizard. What I'll do is I'll quickly show you an existing service. So a service is nothing but a combination of a particular image and a set of configuration properties. So this particular service has these properties. You can define the properties and some default values. Whenever you launch this stack or provision an environment from this stack, you will be asked for the real values for that environment. So here you have properties and some default values. So this configuration plus this image together is basically what makes up this particular service. And then a service could also have a set of deployment commands, a set of deployment properties. We'll get into that in a little bit of time. And I'll also show you later how this image is getting automatically created. But for now, we have this stack, which is the blueprint for this particular application. And let's then create an environment from this particular stack. So we have a few environments already running here for the Dublin app, but I'll go ahead and create a new environment. So I click the environment wizard. Let's call this demo Dublin. So stacks can have different versions. Your stacks may start having more services in future, that sort of thing. And one of the things that HighScale asks you for is, what shard do you want to launch this environment in? So a shard is like a group of instances, a set of VMs or instances that you would have specified you know, for the platform to use. We'll see how to specify that later. But basically, I have a set of instances for QA, a set of instances for stage, and so on. When I select this shard, what's happening is that HighScale will launch all the containers of this particular environment on these set of instances. It will automatically figure out which instances have the right amount of memory and capacity, and it will also try to distribute the containers across instances for high availability purposes. All right. So now that we said we want to launch this, this particular stack has these services, and it says how many containers do you want to run for each of these services. You can always scale this up later after launching it as well. You can also specify what size of containers you want, so you have small, medium, large, and all of that. We'll just go with the defaults for now. The next thing is configuration properties. So you saw these configuration properties in the stack earlier. So here it asks you what are the real values, you know, for the different properties that you want. So you could have things like log levels. You want it to point it to a particular log server. You could have different log levels for different environments, different for staging, different for production, and so on. And then one of the key things here that you see is for every service, HighScale provides that service with an endpoint. So, for example, Dublin UI is the endpoint for this particular service. So other services can reach this service just by using this name instead of the IP. So the IP is automatically figured out at runtime, so there's automatic service discovery happening. So we just need to specify, so for example, the Apache service wants to talk to the UI app. So where is the UI app? That's where it is. And so we just, you know, kind of easily provide the service bindings. So with that, let's go to the next step. So now it says, what are the health checks you want for each of the services? We support TCP as well as HTTP health checks. I'll just provide one HTTP health check. We have a sample script in this particular image, so we just use that for the HTTP health check. You can specify health checks for various services. We'll leave these for default for now. And finally, in the last step, you need to specify in case you need to deploy. So in the case of this particular Dublin app, the various images that we have, the image just consists of the service. So for example, it might just have Java and Tomcat, but it doesn't. The image doesn't have the application artifact itself. So the WAR file or any jars are not part of the image. So this is one way of doing application delivery. You could always do the other way, which is putting the WAR files inside the image as well. But for now, since a lot of teams are used to this kind of a deployment, and typically the services tend to be pretty constant for a long period of time, you want to make that immutable. So we'll go this way. So all right, so we pick a few of these services for which we want a deployment to happen, and then I'll go ahead and say okay, create. So with that, a new application environment is getting launched, and you will see that containers have started coming up, and in a couple of minutes the whole environment should be up and running. So there you go, more containers coming up, services getting started, and so on. So while this environment is starting up, I'll take a short detour, and we'll go look at how the image itself is created. So we saw that the stack and the services in the stack are made up of different images. And Mayur talked about automatic image creation. So what is that? How does it work? So I'm in the images section here, and you could either import images into the platform, and you can get images from either your own Docker registry, private Docker registry, or from Docker Hub. You can specify these registries in the settings section, and then specify what images you want to pull in and bring those images into HiScale, or you can create an image. Now, in order to create an image, we'll go look at what packages are. So these are just software packages. So for example, I have this Tomcat package. A Tomcat package within HiScale is just a set of commands. The installation commands that you use for installing Tomcat. There's nothing Docker specific here. These are scripts that you probably already have with you somewhere, and you can just bring that in, small script that tells you how to install Tomcat. How do you configure Tomcat? You can put in some configuration commands. You can put a start command. So what's the command to start this particular service? So you bring in these commands. You can also specify a set of environment variables or configuration variables that you require. So these are the variables that you require. So it would finally, when you launch an environment or a container from that image at a later point in time, it would ask you for the values for these variables, which we saw earlier. And once you've defined these variables, you can refer them in these commands as well. So there's a specific format. So this is the format for referring to certain variables, and that's how you bring in your software packages. So you have packages for Tomcat, for Java, and so on. So once you've brought some of your existing scripts and packages here, you can then go in and create an image. So let's click create an image, and what I'm going to do is, let's create a Tomcat image here. You can provide some versions. So I can create an image out of the packages that we just saw. We can select the packages in the next step. Or if I already have a Docker file, I can use that as well. And we also support automatic creation of Docker images from Chef recipes in case you use Chef. And so let's pick the operating system. We support a bunch of different operating systems. I'll just select Ubuntu 14.04 for now. And it says, okay, what are the packages that you want to create an image out of? So let's pick Java. I have a bunch of Java images here. Let's pick one. Let's pick Tomcat. And let's pick one more. Let's pick file B. So it's an agent that sends logs to logs dash. So I pick just three packages. And in the next step, it says, okay, provide me any default values that you want for these configuration properties. And so I could go ahead and provide that. So these are the properties that you saw in the packages section for each of those packages. So it kind of brought all those properties together of all the three packages that we selected. And then I can just review everything that I have picked and confirm. And then it basically starts creating an image out of those packages, the three that we specified. So you can see Java, Filebeat, and Tomcat. This would take a minute or two. And what it will do is essentially it creates a Docker file for you automatically and then builds a Docker image and then pushes that Docker image into a Docker, an internal Docker registry, which we ship. So you get a private Docker registry as part of the HiveScale platform. So we'll just give this a couple of minutes, and towards the end of the demo, I'll come back and show you the image and what it has. So let's now go back to our app and see what happened. I think the environment should have come up. So yeah, you can see here, so the demo Dublin app is running, it's fully deployed. If I go into services, I get a URL for it. I could set up my own CNAME or things like that. But essentially, you know, that's how easily and quickly you can provision an application environment within a few minutes, right, using your app stack. So I'll just log into this environment quickly. So there you go. That's the app up and running. If I come back, I can see that there's a container for each of these four services. I can look at the health of it, so there's a health check that's happening continuously. And you can also see memory and CPU usage for each of these containers, the logs. You can also send logs to Logstash. You can do that sort of integration, so you could have a Logstash package to send logs. You can also integrate external monitoring systems if you already use certain monitoring systems so that you can get container stats outside. A couple of other things, you can also easily scale up. So I could just go in here and say, okay, I'm going to have two containers and click update. And then it basically starts trying to bring up another container. So there you go. You see a new container has started to come up here. So two Apache containers, basically any traffic that goes to this particular service, it will then start getting load balanced across these two containers. And so you can scale any service that you want. Obviously, this works well for stateless services. And then we also support auto-healing. So with auto-healing, what happens is that if a container dies or if the service inside that container stops responding, basically the platform will then replace it with a good container. A healthy container. So that's auto healing, and then we also support auto scaling. So if you turn on auto scaling, you'll say, okay, what do you want to scale on? So we support CPU and memory based, and you can specify various parameters to both scale up and scale down. So with that, what we'll do is we've seen how to bring up an environment, how you can manage that environment. I want to show you a little bit of application delivery, because that I think is the key theme that we want to talk about. There's a few other environments here for Dublin. So there's a QA, there's a stage, and a live Dublin environment. We've created a Jenkins pipeline, which is linked to those three environments. So this is a typical Jenkins pipeline using a few Jenkins plugins, as well as the HiveScale plugin for Jenkins. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a small change to my application itself and push the change to VCS, and you'll see this pipeline in action. So this is my application. I have it open in my online editor. What I'm going to do is make a small change. So there's this label here in the application. I'm going to change this particular label to let's say 6.0, 5.2. So I'll save the change. Right. And let's push this change to the VCS, right? So we'll provide a comment here, conversion to 6.0. Let's click OK. And we will need to specify the Git report to which we need to push. So let me go grab some Git credentials quickly. Okay, so let's push that change to the Git repository that we have for this particular application. Should take just a few seconds. Yeah, and as soon as that happens, you see here automatically a new build got triggered. So I just switched back to the Jenkins page. So this is a new build, build number 142 got triggered. The build is in progress. Just a Git hook. It's nothing high scale specific there. This is the change that I made to the application, bumped the version to 6.0. And in just a few seconds, the build will be done, and you will see a deployment happening to the QA environment in HighScale. So I showed you the Dublin QA environment, and we can go back and look at it, and you'll see that the deployment is happening to that environment. So this is happening through the HighScale plugin. We'll see how that is. Let me go back to the QA environment. So you can see here, it is now in a deploying status, and there's certain apps that are getting deployed, certain services that are getting deployed as part of the Jenkins pipeline. How is this deploy happening? If you look at the Jenkins job itself, it has this plugin deployed to HighScale. So this step is here in the Jenkins job. Because of the plugin that we have. You provide the application environment ID and the service ID and whatever properties, and that's how you configure the job. You can look up these IDs from the HighScale console and set up this kind of a job. So then the deploy happens, and once the deploy is done, we run a you might want to run a few tests, so the test will automatically kick off. This is the whole continuous integration and delivery process that you want to set up, right? So there you go. So the QA, we just run some sample tests, and now it's waiting for a manual approval, so which would trigger the stage deploy to the staging environment in HighScale. So all of this is happening using the plugin, and the plugin is internally using a REST API that we expose. So pretty much everything that you're seeing in the UI here, not just the deployment, but all of the operations, we expose via REST API so that you can integrate with your own tools. So that's the CI/CD process. If you just, I think if you go back to this particular app, you should see that the app has deployed. So give it a few seconds. There you go. So there you go. So the Dublin version 6.0, the change that I made is here. So that's a glimpse of CI/CD. I'll quickly touch upon the image that we tried to build now. Go back to that. So the image has been built. It's complete. A Docker file was generated automatically for that particular image, and the Docker build has happened behind the scenes, and you will see the Docker build logs here. So this is the standard Docker build log. So under the hood, it's all standard Docker, Docker containers and Docker images. But as DevOps, as application delivery folks who want to use the platform, you don't need to know or mess with any of the Docker stuff, Docker Compose or build configs or things like that. Finally, I want to touch upon the infrastructure a little bit. I talked about shards, which is a set of instances. If I go look at my staging shard, it has these two instances. Fairly easy to add an instance and increase the capacity of this particular shard. And I can go look at what are the containers, what are the instances we have in this particular shard, what is the memory usage. You can see the capacity, how much is used, and what containers are running in each of these instances of this particular shard. So you can create your own shards. It's just a way of grouping different instances, and I can get some more detailed information, detailed graphs here. So that gives a glimpse of the infrastructure side of things, and hopefully all of this gives you a glimpse of what is available in a container platform like HighScale, and what HighScale can specifically do for you. So with that, I'll hand over back to Mayur.
Hey, thanks Anoop. Thanks for that great demo and shows the entire application delivery process. So let's go back to the last section of the webinar. Hopefully you guys can see my screen now. So we'll now touch upon a couple of real-world case studies of our product. The first case study I'd like to talk to you about is a customer who had an omni-channel application, and essentially the goal was to containerize his application. The application itself consisted of close to about 15 microservices, and these were different services of the application itself. So with Waymaker HighScale, we were able to take the application with all its services and dependencies and configuration and be able to containerize the entire application in a matter of 2 weeks. So some of the services also included external databases for persistence, and that was kept outside the environment, and the entire application was containerized in a matter of 2 weeks. In terms of the optimizations due to HighScale for this specific omnichannel application, we were able to drastically reduce the infrastructure need from the current need in terms of the number of VMs it was using, to drastically reduce that from to about 75% savings in terms of the infrastructure cost. Also, in terms of the gains in terms of the deployment of new environments to set up new deployments, we were able to reduce that from multiple hours to a matter of few minutes. So you can see that overall there was great value add in terms of optimizations, in terms of reducing the time to deliver, as well as the infrastructure cost reduction to as part of the containerized application delivery. Another case study I'd like to also talk to you about is a global SaaS application that is powered by HighScale. And basically, here we have a situation where this SaaS application is being used globally by developers across the world. And with HighScale, we are seeing the ability to manage this sort of SaaS application so that it can support this kind of workloads. The application itself has 16,000 plus users, on an average has 200 plus concurrent users who are logging into the application at any given point in time. We see that there are about 100,000 plus containers that are provisioned on a yearly basis. In terms of the number of applications and application hits, we're talking about a very, very large number. The most important thing is the time taken to provision new containers is of the, in terms of latency, is 10 seconds. And on an average, to deploy an application in an entire application environment is about 45 seconds. So you can see that with this, with HighScale containerization platform, the SaaS platform is able to benefit to a great extent. A little bit about the adoption process itself. We see that one of the key unique differentiation of HighScale is its adoption. You can take this platform and install it in a matter of 2 to 4 hours, and any onboarding of an application or a custom product to containerize that takes a matter of 2 to 4 weeks. So as opposed to months that you would see earlier. And then additional setup of environments and upgrades are a matter of minutes. So overall, we see that as a big benefit for enterprises who are, and ISVs who are looking to adopt containerization for their specific workloads, because this now you don't need a very specialized professional development team or highly specialized skills to use this platform. We are very eager to offer a trial for customers and businesses. In terms of the trial, we will offer a fitment assessment where our teams will work with your teams to do a fitment assessment and understanding your application. And then we offer a 45-day trial, complete full-feature trial. It could be an online trial or an on-premise trial where you can take your custom application, your custom workload, and then containerize that. And then finally, we can help you in the adoption as well. So with that, I would like now to move over to the Q&A session. Let's look at the questions that are asked, and we will answer those questions in this session. So the first question is about vendor lock-in. What about vendor lock-in if I were to use your platform for containerizing my applications, and how open is the platform? Anoop, can you answer that?
Yeah. So basically, as I mentioned during the demo as well, so under the hood, it's all standard Docker containers and Docker images. And if at some point of time you want to pull those images out of the inbuilt Docker registry that we ship, you can always pull those images and use them elsewhere. So it's all based on standard Docker. The only special sauce that we provide on top is to the ability to automatically create images and the ability to do rapid application delivery with a full stack of containers. So since it's all based on Docker, I think that's fairly open in that sense.
Okay, we have another question. You mentioned the ability to work with multiple clouds. Can I run my application workload on Google Cloud if I need to? And I can answer that. The answer to that is yes. In the demonstration, we talked about the notion of shards, where shards are logical grouping of instances, and these instances can be instances from your data center machines, it could be instances from bare metal machines, or it could be instances from any virtualized instance on a cloud provider. So the cloud providers today we support are Amazon, Azure, as well as Google Cloud. So basically, through that concept of instances that can basically transcend from on-prem to cloud, we have the support to support multiple clouds as well. We have another question. In the demonstration, we saw Jenkins plugin and integrating HighScale with the pipeline. We don't use Jenkins. Are there any ways to integrate with other tools as well? Anoop, do you want to take that?
Sure. So as I mentioned, even the Jenkins plugin that we provide basically uses the REST APIs under the hood. So the Jenkins plugin is basically taking all the parameters you specify in the Jenkins job and then invoke the REST APIs. Now, you could use those REST APIs in any other tool. So, for example, if you use TeamCity, you could integrate with TeamCity and invoke those APIs quite easily. So we would definitely provide you with the API documentation to be able to do that.
Okay, we have one more question. How does HighScale compare with Kubernetes? One more for you, Anoop.
Yeah. So I think one of the things we saw is that we're a very application-centric platform. where you don't need to worry about Docker or pods or deployment configuration files or Docker compose files or anything of that sort. So they really abstract out everything to the level where you are dealing with your application. I think that's a very key difference. Another thing is, so Kubernetes is basically, it was built for, you know, or designed and built for running millions of containers. Essentially, if you wanted to, you know, take your entire data center and support transformation across a data center and where you run various kinds of homogeneous workloads. So those are the kind of use cases, and that also brings, that kind of scale also brings complexity. And we've typically seen that companies tend to go for consulting services to help them set up and run Kubernetes and so on. And as Mayur mentioned earlier, you know, high scale is much simpler to set up, maintain, and run. And you can also adopt one application at a time, or just a few applications at a time, as many as you wish, to speed up the application delivery.
Thanks, Anup. We have another question. You know, can you talk a little bit about disruption? You know, a lot of times in the presentation, you talked about minimal disruption. Can you talk a little bit more about that in terms of how it causes minimal disruption?
Yeah, I can take that. So basically, a lot of teams have a certain way of doing things. For instance, one of the things that I showed in the demo earlier is how you can just have container images that have just the service, right? And then you do war file deployments to it. And many teams, even today, do that. So they just do war file deployments using Tomcat Manager or JBoss Manager or whatever else, or if it's Ruby or something else, right? So they have a certain way to do deployments. Now, going back to development teams and saying, you know, you don't provide me war files, but your deliverable is now a Docker image, is a huge change for the developers because they aren't used to that kind of a thing. And it might take some time to get to that kind of a situation. And so what Highscale does as a platform is it supports both the old style of doing deployments as well as, you know, if teams wanted to generate a Docker image for every single build of their application, that can be supported as well. So essentially supporting both the old and the new ways so that we don't disrupt the way that things are happening right now, but at the same time, we allow teams to scale up to newer and better ways of doing things. I think that's what we mean. Another point is, I think Mayur mentioned during his presentation, is we also support both monolithic applications, you know, three-tier applications, as well as microservices. So we don't really force people to build their apps in one way or another in order to adopt containers and to become to take advantage of containers. So in all of these ways, we try not to disrupt the existing workflows, the way teams operate, while also supporting newer ways to do things.
Sure. Thanks, Anup. And one final question. You know, we just have a couple of minutes more. So one final question. You showed war file deployments to containers. Isn't it better to put the war file as well inside the container image itself and generate the new image for each build?
Yeah, I think I just mentioned a little bit about that in the previous answer as well. That you could do both ways. You could either put your war file inside and generate images every time, generate Docker images for every build of your app, or you know, you can just have your application services in the images and do war file deployments on top, using the deployment commands and the way that I showed in the demo. So typically what happens is this, the stack of your application, the services, they rarely change. And so you want those to be immutable. Whereas the build artifacts, the wars and the jars and things like that, they might change very often. Sometimes multiple times a day you generate war files. So whether you want to take the extra overhead of generating images every time, or you just want to make those deployments separately, is a choice, and we support both ways.
Thanks, Anup. I think that answers the questions that we had. I would like to sincerely take this time to thank all of the attendees to take time out of their precious morning or afternoon and attend this webinar. Thank you so much. We will send the recording and the slides to you as well. And we will encourage you and your teams to look at HighScale as a way to containerize your applications if you're looking to move in that direction. And we are here to assist your teams and help you to a successful trial. Thank you so much for joining this webinar, and